Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy. My name is Kishore Mahbubani, and I'm the dean here. And it gives me great pleasure to welcome you to the opening ceremony for the Global Redesign Initiative Singapore Hearing, which is jointly sponsored by the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of Singapore, the World Economic Forum, and the Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy. The first point I was going to make is that clearly the demand for global governments is growing by leaps and bounds, growing day by day. I had never seen such doom and gloom as I did in January this year, and everyone thought that the world was coming to an end. But fortunately, one small aspect of global governance kicked into action. The G20 meetings came in, and surprisingly, through their coordinated action, responded. But that was one indication of the growing demand. The other, of course, is that you can see in the pandemics that are spreading around the world, and I can tell you that even this meeting has become a casualty. One of our participants at this meeting was Professor Steven Stedman from California, and he couldn't come because he contracted the H1N1 virus. So we can see that that's why we need to have global governance. And of course, in a few weeks' time, we're going to see the big Copenhagen meeting, which is supposed to address the need to respond to climate change. And you can see what's going to happen down there, and you'll see why there's a demand for global governance. But my second point is that while the demand is growing, the supply is diminishing. Indeed, at a time when the world should be coming together to react to this great global crisis, in many ways the opposite is happening, and in many ways governments are indeed reluctant to come together and cooperate. I mentioned that the G20 was a relatively successful initiative, relatively successful in dealing with the financial crisis, but yet when the G20 was asked to come together to respond to climate change, you could see how the difficulties arose, and the same group that could take care of one issue couldn't take care of another issue. And so we will see, in a sense, growing challenges given the reluctance of governments to come together and handle these issues, and we've got to find ways and means of increasing the supply of global governance. And this is my third point, this explains why this meeting is being held. When governments all over the world are struggling to find the right answers, it's good to create other initiatives to bring people together to discuss these issues. And in some ways, you have a perfect partnership here of three organizations, the World Economic Forum, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, and our school, because each one of us is trying to make a significant contribution. Certainly, the whole Global Redesign Initiative by the World Economic Forum is a major initiative. It's a major commitment by the World Economic Forum. And indeed, you will see at next year's Davos meeting, as Rick will explain, a major focus on the Global Redesign Initiative. And I can tell you that in addition to what the World Economic Forum has done in Davos, it's organized two spectacular meetings in Dubai, both in November last year and November this year, where they brought together 700 of the best public intellectuals in the world to come and sit together in various global agenda councils. I have participated in both, and I can tell you that they made a huge difference in terms of moving the debate and agenda forward. And on the part of our school, I can tell you that for a small school, it is quite amazing that we have actually launched a major project called the Dr. Lee Seng Tee Project on Global Governance. And we had a big meeting last year, which was opened by Minister Giorgio and Strobe Talbot, the former Deputy Secretary of State, and we're carrying on the work. Indeed, I'm glad that many of the participants in the STD project on global governance are also participating in this meeting. And I was telling the Minister and Rick Samans earlier that the conclusions that will come from these studies will hopefully, be very helpful also for the World Economic Forum as it finalizes its report. And of course, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs has made a major contribution to and in joining the World Economic Forum. And as you know, three small countries are working together with the World Economic Forum to have hearings. The first one was held in Switzerland. The second one was held in Qatar. And of course, we saved the best for last. The third one is in Singapore. And this is the hearing that we're having. But this three-country cooperation, especially on the part of small countries, is an important contribution, which we hope will also help the World Economic Forum in its deliberations. So those are my opening remarks, which I hope will explain why we're having this meeting at this point in time. And now it gives me great pleasure to call on Rick Samans, Managing Director of the World Economic Forum, to make his remarks. He's had a very distinguished career, both in the United States, worked a long time on Capitol Hill, worked in the Clinton administration, and has been with the World Economic Forum since 2001, and indeed has been at the forefront of all the efforts that the World Economic Forum has been putting in on global governance initiatives. And so in some ways, it's very appropriate, Rick, that you're here to address us on this occasion. Thank you very much, Rick.
Thank you very much, Kishore. Welcome to everyone. We're very pleased to be here in Singapore this week for what is a very important link in this chain of thinking that we have been organizing and that has been unfolding now for, the better part of this year and will continue for another year or so. Let me just say that first to thank the Lee Kuan Yew School and particularly the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, and thank you, Minister Lim, for your role in helping to bring about this very important step along the way of our thinking as an independent and neutral and multi-stakeholder and interdisciplinary platform for thinking through some of the longer-term issues that confront us in the international system. I guess I'd like to say just a couple things, one on the substance and one on the process, so people have a better understanding of where this this dialogue here this week in Singapore is situated in this in our process going forward. First, a couple of substantive reflections. You know, since the fall of the Berlin Wall 20 years ago, there has been quite a cottage industry and speculation about the new world order. And in my view, that's really been a long running debate or discussion which has really not had any conclusion, or there's not been much crystallization there. And however, it seems that with the financial crisis, in my view, that might be more of a galvanizing factor for thinking about what the international system is moving toward than the fall of the Berlin Wall and the dissolution of the Soviet Empire. And for that, the reason for that is that I think what is needed for a major restructuring of the way the world organizes itself is a fundamental rethinking about our relationship with each other. And while, yes, the bipolarity of the world during the Cold War did provide some sort of a framework for the way countries think about how they relate to each other, I happen to think that deepened interdependence is probably a more powerful stimulus to that kind of a reflection going forward. And it's not just in an economic sense. I think we've arrived at a moment in history where people around the world are absorbing the implications of the fact that they are more closely connected. Certainly the financial crisis gave a very specific and concrete set of almost sometimes scary indications that we are much more closely linked. But it's not just solely in the economic sphere. It's also in the technological domain, in the environmental domain. If you look at the debates about weapons of mass destruction, or you consider the momentous negotiations that will be taking place in a couple of weeks, which I think are emblematic of a wider understanding that the world is much more closely linked in security terms, I think that it is this type of cultural awakening that is occurring at varying levels across the world about how much more closely intertwined our destinies are that is likely to be the petri dish out of which we're going to see some reorganization of the way we cooperate with each other. And so that's why, in part, the forum thought, as the crisis was gathering full force last spring, as we thought about what might be a useful purpose for a non-governmental, independent, multi-stakeholder platform, we thought that perhaps a useful contribution would be to make our platform available for this type of reflection. What are the consequences of deep interdependence for the way nation states and communities around the world need to relate to each other in order to achieve their security objectives more effectively? And so this Global Redesign Initiative has cultivated a wide-ranging dialogue across all of our meetings for the past year, and will do so for the year going forward, including in Davos, where we will devote somewhere between a third to a half of our sessions on issues related to international cooperation. And then at the heart of that wide-ranging dialogue, we have also convened, as Dean Mahbubani had just indicated, a whole series of interdisciplinary task forces, which we call Global Agenda Councils, to deliberate and hopefully cooperate on the development of some very concrete proposals for how international cooperation could be improved, not just in the structures of decision-making, but at least as importantly, in the effectiveness by which that cooperation manifests itself in results. And so those proposals will be coming out over the next year or so, and they will be a stimulus to a further wave of dialogue through our platforms and through the media, both traditional and informal. And that is why we think that the discussions here this week are quite important, because as you know, the theme here, Asia's role in the international system going forward, is one that one hears about whenever one goes around the world and talks about these issues. Given that there is a shift in influence that is palpable toward the east from the west, toward the south from the north, the natural question that arises in all quarters is, well, how will that manifest itself in the way we organize ourselves and in the way we deliver on our objectives? And central to that question, of course, is the role of Asia and what Asia itself perceives as its key interests in improved international cooperation going forward. That's, the broadly speaking, the topic of the two-day deliberation we'll be having here. I want to thank again, particularly Dean Mahbubani and his colleagues, for helping to structure what looks to be an excellent program of discussion. And I want to indicate that there is a very ready market for these ideas in this initiative, because if there's one thing the forum wants to do in this process is to provide some sort of a systemic view rather than simply just a laundry list of interesting individual proposals. And one of the big systemic questions hanging over global governance is exactly this one. How will Asia's role and influence be felt? What's the most constructive way for it to be manifested? So with that, on behalf of my colleague, our chief advisor for the Global Redesign Initiative, Lord Mark Malik Brown, who's with us here today and who's going to be cooperating actively in the discussion, and this is an individual who, as many of you know, has perhaps been involved more than any other individual over the last 20 years in many of these questions, I want to indicate to you how serious we are in the outcome of the discussions and to say that we're going to be engaging fully with you in them. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much, Rick. And thank you very much for mentioning that we have the distinguished participation of Lord Mark Mallet Brown, and indeed we have the distinguished participation of many distinguished people in this meeting, including Ms. Nolene Hazer, the head of ESCAP, who's taken time off a busy schedule to be here, and that's why I'm confident that we will have a very good meeting. Rick Samans mentioned that this is a multi-stakeholder exercise. I want to emphasize that this is a multidisciplinary exercise where many disciplines have to come together to address the issues of global governance. And this is why it's particularly appropriate that we have Minister Raymond Lim, the Minister for Transport and Second Minister of Foreign Affairs, to launch this event, because he's had a truly multidisciplinary background in his career. He studied economics at the University of Adelaide on a Colombo Plan scholarship. He then subsequently won a Rhodes Scholarship to read law at Oxford University, and then he went on to get a master's degree in public international law in Cambridge. He started work as a law lecturer here at the National University of Singapore, and we're very pleased that the law faculty is our neighbor here, Minister Lim, before joining the Straits Times as a journalist. He then entered the financial industry, where he held various positions, including with Kim Eng Securities, ABN AMRO Securities, DBS Securities, and of course, finally, Managing Director of Strategic Overview of Business at Temasek Holdings. He was first elected to Parliament in 2001 and appointed Minister of State for Foreign Affairs and Minister of State for Industry then, and that's when I had the pleasure of working with Minister Raymond Lim in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. Then he was given the additional responsibility of being Minister of State in charge of entrepreneurship in 2005. In 2005, he was appointed Minister in the Prime Minister's Office, Second Minister for Finance, and Second Minister for Foreign Affairs. In 2006, he became Minister for Transport, where he continues to serve concurrently as the Second Minister for Foreign Affairs. So thank you very much, Minister Lim, for giving us your time this morning. I turn the floor to you.
Thank you very much, Kishore. The reason why I have such a diverse career is I can't hold down a job for too long, any one job. Before I came up here, I had a discussion with Kishore, Rick, and Mark, and they explained to me the process. They said it's going to take, it's a two-year process, an iterative process. So that's when it struck me that this is really a different world. You know, it takes 2 years to change the world, but in the old days, it took 7 days. Professor Wong Gangwu, Chairman of Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy. Professor Kishore Mahbubani, Dean of Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy. Mr. Rick Samans, Managing Director, World Economic Forum. Lord Mark Malik Brown, Special Advisor, World Economic Forum. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. I'm delighted to join you all this morning, and I wish to commend the LKY School of Public Policy and World Economic Forum for putting together this Singapore hearing. This is a period of significant transition in world affairs. The transition is being propelled not by conflict, as used to be historically more significant, but by common threats which afflict us all. The challenges of our time are multidimensional and have been made more complex by globalization and technology. We've all become more acutely aware that unless we work closely together to deal with these common challenges and threats, as nations, civil society organizations and individuals, the problems of the global financial crisis, climate change, terrorism, and a host of other transnational threats and issues cannot be dealt with effectively. That being said, with these challenges also come opportunities to reshape international institutions and norms and to reframe global and regional architectures. While countries have always paid lip service to the need for cooperation and collaboration, today we all recognize that this is absolutely imperative and that we need to enhance global governance. Asia's role is critical. The rise of Asia was already clear before the financial crisis hit us. But the financial crisis underscored the growing weight of Asia in global economic affairs relative to the West and, in fact, accelerated the process. Where the process leads will determine the global landscape in the coming years. When President Barack Obama announced at the Pittsburgh G20 summit that the G20 would replace the G8, he implicitly acknowledged the end of the post-World War II world order. The rise of China is by now a familiar story. China is expected to achieve 8% or more growth in 2009. China, with its reserve of over US $2 trillion, is the biggest creditor of the US government. This makes it a major stakeholder in the US economy and consequently the global economy. With each year, the gap between China, the US, and Japan will narrow. In 20 to 30 years, China's GDP will surpass the US, even though its per capita GDP would still be a quarter of the US. India, too, will have an increasingly important role to play in global affairs. The World Bank recently projected in 2010, India's economy will grow at a rate of 8%. India's growth has been fueled by the sheer size of its population and the entrepreneurial spirit. The U.S. acknowledged India has a key role to play. Prime Minister Manmohan Singh was President Obama's first official guest at the White House. India and China are the larger, but not the only facets of the Asian story. Japan and Korea are key players too. Korea will host the G20 summit next year, the first time by an Asian country. Placed between the giants of China and India is ASEAN, playing a major role in shaping a network of cooperation in the Asia-Pacific region. ASEAN is at the center of a web of regional forums and structures which it has been driving in order to strengthen the regional architecture. ASEAN itself is progressing towards closer integration with the signing of the ASEAN Charter and the creation of an economic community by 2015. In the broader region, ASEAN plus three, that is including China, Japan, and South Korea, has become an established process for concrete cooperation, including mechanisms for economic and financial surveillance. The larger East Asia Summit, comprising ASEAN plus China, Japan, South Korea, India, Australia, and New Zealand, is also developing substance. As you know, Singapore just hosted the APEC Economic Leaders Meeting. This was a culmination of our 2009 APEC chairmanship and also an occasion to celebrate the 20th anniversary of APEC. With its core mission of promoting regional economic integration, APEC is a vital piece of the regional architecture. It also serves as a useful forum for the US and a rising Asia to engage each other and manage the shifting equilibrium. Elements of the regional architecture like APEC, the ASEAN Regional Forum, and East Asia Summit play an important role in providing structure and balance the new multipolar reality. They have the critical function of ensuring that the region remains stable and open. They also provide a robust framework for economic cooperation. Their representative structures give everyone a stake in the region, which is key in ensuring Asia's continued growth and stability. The relationship between the US and China has become the most important geopolitical issue of this century. Whether Asia can continue to have dynamic growth in a stable and peaceful environment will depend upon how these two countries conduct themselves and, more critically, on how they conduct their relations with each other. For the immediate term, the strength of recovery of the US economy is the critical swing factor in global forecasts for 2010. The IMF's October Asian Economic Outlook highlighted that US consumption was responsible for about a quarter of Asia's export value added, and this has created a significant vulnerability. As the report stated, if over the coming decade US consumption slows dramatically, the impact on Asia's growth could be sizable. At the same time, the Asian countries will have to do their part as responsible stakeholders and shoulder their fair share of the burden in the international system. The reform of the share quota at the World Bank and IMF agreed to at the G20 Pittsburgh Summit is a case in point. We must work together across countries and across continents to reach a consensus on the big issues and make our interdependence work for the benefit of all. We need more effective mechanisms to engage the various parties for better coordination, cooperation, and enforcement in many areas, ranging from international financial regulation to combating pandemics, climate change, and terrorism. If we are to be most effective, it is not just governments that need to be engaged and involved in global decision-making, but also non-state actors like civil society organizations. Post-financial crisis, the G20 has emerged as a good framework to discuss global issues. It is a more inclusive framework than the G8. The G20 has seen governments coming together to tackle the financial crisis, but this cooperation will have to continue beyond the crisis. G20 marks the start of a process of reshaping the global architecture that is needed for a more complex and interconnected world. The G20 process itself requires better definition. As we begin to deal with core global issues, the G20 will need to be more consultative and transparent in its deliberations. All countries, big and small, will be affected by how the G20 deals with these issues. For the G20's deliberations to be translated into effective actions on a global scale, these decisions need to be seen as legitimate. This will require the G20 to develop appropriate mechanisms to engage and consult a wider range of countries. A key challenge in global governance for the G20 and other similar mechanisms is to strike the right balance between the competing imperatives of effectiveness and inclusiveness. If a meeting is too big, it becomes unwieldy. If too small, it lacks representation and legitimacy, effectiveness and legitimacy. In this regard, I would like to offer three practical proposals. First, ensure the involvement of the UN, UN agencies, or the Bretton Woods institutions, such as the World Bank and the IMF, which have the requisite mandates, technical skills, and most importantly, the legitimacy to deal with key global issues. It is important for all states, especially smaller states which comprise the majority of UN members, to be given the opportunity to raise issues of concern and have a say in the outcome. Second, consider the involvement of significant regional organizations in discussion on issues of global concern, so as to ensure that all states are engaged in the issues being deliberated upon, thereby enhance the legitimacy of any decisions taken. Third, build insufficient flexibility to allow for the involvement of all parties with significant interest and the capacity to contribute to good outcomes. This will ensure that deliberations on key issues of global concern would engage all the relevant parties so that the decisions would be widely supported. Ladies and gentlemen, crisis and opportunity, we're often reminded, are two sides of the same coin. We now have an extraordinary opportunity to reboot, reshape, and rebuild our global and regional structures to serve us all better. We will require structures to deliver better cooperation and more effective coordination at both the global and regional levels. The imperative is to ensure an open, globalized system that promotes economic interdependence among countries. The greater the stakes in one another's success, the more incentive countries will have to cooperate and uphold a stable world order which fosters growth and prosperity for all. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister, for your opening address. I want to assure you that we'll be considering all the issues that you have raised. We have a very heavy agenda. Many of them touch on the points that you have raised in your opening remarks. I also want to thank all of you for participating in this opening ceremony, especially the many distinguished ambassadors who are here today. We hope to reward you now by inviting you to join us for a very simple, informal lunch that we have organized at the other side of the lobby. With apologies to the ambassadors, there's no protocol. This is a simple academic lunch, and I hope you'll all enjoy it before we begin our plenary sessions at 1 o'clock today in the Li Ka Shing building. So with that, once again, thank you, Minister. Thank you, Rick, for this opening ceremony. Thank you very much. Please, one more round of applause for them.